Down Among the Fishes, written by Natalka Babina, narrated by Sharon Adamus. The Business with the Devil. There was a time when the devil used to torment me terribly. He would track me down almost every day. I did have a few ways of driving him off, but he's a really persistent object. There's no way you can refer to the devil as a person. Time and time again, he would come and jump out at me, whenever and wherever I least expected it. Bald, disgusting, yuck. I was permanently stressed out. After all, it was my immortal soul at stake. Nothing more or less. Just imagine the horror of it. Expecting to see a vision of hell under a saucepan lid, behind a mirror, or beneath the surface of your bath water. Anyone who's ever had any dealings with the devil will know what I'm talking about. Fear completely sapped all my strength. Yet all the same, and to my own astonishment, I managed to sort him out once and for all. I found a way of doing it. I can recommend it to anyone, or to be more precise, to any woman. As I recall, it happened one evening, after a heavy, sultry day. I dragged myself home from the city all sweaty and totally knackered. I pulled off my dress. My tights were stuck firmly to the soles of my feet, and I literally had to rip them off. The smell of exhaustion mixed with, yes, I couldn't ignore it, an overweight woman's body odor. Pulling off the blood-soaked bit of old bedsheet that I had been using in place of a sanitary towel, I headed for the bathroom to get under the shower. And here, in the dark corridor, the devil suddenly jumped out at me from round a corner. He had been relying on the element of surprise, but it was the very unexpectedness of it that led to his undoing. The shock of it caused me to lash out at him with the bloody rag, and at that time the blood was simply pouring out of me, hitting him across his bald pate so hard that dark red stains spattered all over the white wallpaper. I hit him again and again and again. The first blow had been a kind of reflex action, but by now I was thumping him faster and faster, driven by all the loathing that had piled up inside me. Fuck off and die, you bastard! You piece of filth! And he did. He squealed and disappeared, and never came back. To this day, I still don't know. Does menstrual blood have the power to ward off devils? Or was he ashamed that a mere mortal had frightened him? Either way, I don't really care, so long as he doesn't come around me anymore and doesn't stop me digging holes in time. For my part, I never bought hygienic pads after that. It was, after all, a matter of considerable importance to me. A sanitary towel would not have been of as much help to me in driving the devil away as a blood-drenched, torn piece of old sheet had been. So physiology does bring some benefits after all, even to people like me. And the smell of blood is something I can still sense in the air from time to time, even if I don't know where it's coming from. A sack came rolling. In spite of everything that had happened here, I did actually come back. But not for long. I'm going to leave soon and never return. It's beautiful here. Really lovely. Misty, steel-gray sheets of fine rain divide the air over my head and all around me into tiers. Close up, they're greenish-gray. Further away, they look grayish-green. The rain runs down my face and the oilskins I'm wearing. In a way, they are just like each other. Oilskins lose their shine when they're old, and an old face no longer lets the soul shine through. I'm standing right on the frontier. Or, to be exact, where the frontier used to be. On my right, on the other bank of the Bug, I can hear people shouting in Polish. In spite of the rain, someone is swimming in the river. Footnote, River Bug, better known in its Polish form, Bug. The river is sometimes called the Western Bug. To my left, there are people speaking Russian. These are the townies who have dachas, at least those whose crummy shacks haven't yet been bought up by Tolik, the alcoholic. Footnote. Dacha, a cottage in the countryside with a bit of land, owned or rented by someone who lives in a town, somewhere where they can grow their own fruit and vegetables. The cottage can vary from a large purpose-built mansion to something that is little more than a shed. They're always on guard, keeping watch over their fruit and vegetable patches, even in a downpour. So here I am, standing on a narrow strip of water meadow right by the old frontier, in my oilskins and wellies. One scar on my stomach, another, just for the sake of variety, on my back. The bones in my fingers have healed, but the calluses haven't worn away yet. The rain is just teeming down, making the grass bend under the weight of water. A little lizard swims calmly past my foot in a stream the rain has made. It's bright green, with a yellow pattern on its back. This is a top-grade lizard. When I was a child, we got really excited whenever we caught one like this. Much better than the common or garden plain gray ones. I'm amazed at just how much the feet of the lizard, when it spreads them out, are like the tiny hands of a young child. Meadow, water, ripples on the surface of the enormous puddles of rainwater. Calm lizard with a child's hands. Poland on one side, Russia on the other. And from this narrow strip of land between them, I hear a whisper, although I have no idea where it's coming from precisely. A sack comes rolling down the hill. In it is food. Take what you will. There's rye and wheat and soft white rolls to eat. Footnote, a counting rhyme for children. Various things can be put in the bag. I get a sense of being rebuked by these words, or mocked, or even of being thanked in a patronizing kind of way. This is the earth talking to me, the thick, black, waterlogged mud of the river, in a voice you can't hear, you can't pinpoint where it comes from. It's indistinct, but you feel its power. And the earth speaks Ukrainian. A sack did come rolling down the hill, straight into my arms. The price of the sack was a human life. You hold out your arms to catch the sack, but what you catch is death. And then here you stand, under the pouring rain, and the water runs down your faded face, your khaki-colored oilskins, and your green wellies. Right now, I'm going to wipe the water off my face, take a last look at the tears the rain has made in the air, and then go home. Sit down in the one cozy corner that's left where I can write and put everything down on paper, just as it happened. And when that's done, I'm going to leave this place and never come back. And there's something else. Not everything in this story is fictitious, and any resemblance to real persons, living or dead, or real events, is by no means always purely coincidental. If this means that so-called official personages will come and pay me a visit, then I'll simply deny everything. For the benefit of these plainclothes art experts, I can add that the events of the story take place in 2012. Holes in Time. What I like most of all is digging holes in time. When I'm digging them, I now and again hear the earth whispering to me. But not very often. Strace, Ljubce, and Dobratyche. Everything in my life went arse up right from the very start, literally. Against the advice of her mother, so my grandmother, my mother went off to have me in the outpatient clinic of the hospital that had just been opened in the neighboring village. Granny Makrinya, that's what they called my mother's mother, didn't see any need for it, and so tried to dissuade her in her usual manner, with a big stick in her hands. She did not, however, dare to hit her pregnant daughter. So off my mother went to the clinic. After all, she was a teacher, young, educated, with a firm belief in the necessity of progress, drug, and hygiene. The paramedic who was assigned to deliver her baby was also a believer. Maybe his faith wasn't strong enough, or he just didn't have enough experience, or he put his faith in vodka as well as progress. But as soon as the baby was born, my sister Yulia, or as they say around here, Vliana, and without waiting for anything else to happen, he started to stitch up my mother's lacerated vagina, concentrating on trying to make the stitches even. No, 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 we have to stitch it up. This in response to my mother's agonized protests. Otherwise, we'll have your uterus dangling between your knees. Not a pretty sight. And so, on he stitched. My mother, of course, was screaming. Not surprisingly, if your skin and muscles are being sewn up without anesthetic in an open wound, and if, to top it all, the needle being used is a really thick one. She was in such agony that any other feeling was completely blotted out. It came, therefore, as a complete surprise to both her and the paramedic when I suddenly broke through the fresh stitches and burst out into the world. What the fuck? There's something else coming out! According to my mother, these were the exact words used by this latter-day Asclepius as he stood there, rooted to the spot, flabbergasted, with a surgical needle in his hand. In the teacher training college that my mother had gone to in order to get an education, they had no courses on how to give birth. And so she, barely conscious and in terrible pain, was unable to dispel his astonishment. In any case, she didn't have any idea of what was happening either. She had exhausted all her strength during the birth, and when the pain had let up a bit, she had tried to get her breath back, at least. So the paramedic simply stared goggle-eyed at what the medics call the birth canal, and which, in normal language, we try to avoid giving a name to. The entrance to the canal was framed by pubic hairs that weren't exactly what you would call nicely shaved, full of pain and shimmering blood, and gaping wider and wider like a pulsating star. Fortunately for me, it was right at this moment that the nurse came back into the ward. Thanks to her, I didn't end up being dropped on the floor. She grabbed me from the arms of the gobsmacked laborer in the vineyard of public health care and managed to prevent him from starting to stitch my mother up again until the placenta had come out. Only an hour later, everyone in Dobratyche already knew that Makrinya's girl Eva had given birth to twin girls. That's us, me and my sister. After the nurse had washed and swaddled me and Yulia, they all, that is, the nurse, my mother, and the paramedic, who still had an utterly gormless expression on his face, noticed how alike we were. Peas in a pod. Mum always used to say that we stopped crying once we had been born and just lay there looking at the world with identical dark eyes. The paramedic said we were okay, but neither my mother nor the nurse took any notice of him. I now think that we weren't crying because we had no idea what the sequel was going to be. We didn't know that people are not born for their own benefit. At best, they are born so that someone else benefits from it. Although my sister and I looked alike, it was easy to tell us apart once we had begun to walk. I walked with a limp. Mum was in despair when she saw this, and rushed me off to a woman doctor in Brest. She said that the limp was the result of an injury sustained during birth, because the baby came out feet first, and it should soon pass. It still hasn't passed, although you don't really notice it now. It was late spring when we were born, a spring of a self-confident kind that you don't get anymore in our parts. There were occasional gusts of cold wind. On the sandy hills, the pussy willows drooped even more with catkins in full bloom. The railway embankment was speckled white with the flowering spurge that had come with the gravel strewn under the tracks. Tiny white five-petaled flowers of chickweed trembled on beds of brown moss in forest clearings. Yellow marsh marigolds flourished on the silt left behind when the river changed its course. These are the earth's soft colors. There were hardly any people around. That was the spring when they replaced the wooden posts on the frontier with concrete ones that lasted for about 30 years. They were constantly replacing the barbed wire. My mum, Eva, and my dad, whose name, by the way, wasn't Adam, but Anatole, or Tolik, as my mum called him, won't appear in this story. So I had better say a few words about them now, just out of filial respect. Both of them died when Yulia and I were 9. I don't even remember what they looked like. I've got a bad memory for faces, especially when I try to imagine them close up. I don't think I can recall what they were actually like as people. But I can remember that the focal point of my mum's life, second only to her fear of hunger, something that everyone in our parts had a phobia about, was her fear of anything associated with machinery. She was afraid of cars, of roads, of electricity, of domestic appliances, and even of the drugs that brought progress in hygiene, things that it was her job as a teacher at a primary school to promote. I vaguely remember how, whenever Dad was held up at work or anywhere else for more than 10 minutes, her face would change, although I still cannot remember anything about her facial features, and she would start howling and weeping, and so gradually reduce my sister and me to a state of tearful hysteria. Tolik, our daddy, was the one we have to thank for the fact that we can both speak Russian without an accent. Right from the time we were born, he deliberately spoke only Russian to us so that we would learn it. He had had to learn the language on his own, because his parents, of course, didn't know a word. He made his way in the world so well that the factory where he worked gave him a flat in Brest, and a year later, he reached the top of the queue to get a car. There weren't any car dealerships back then, where you could just walk in and buy a car. You had to join the queue, and when your turn came, off you had to go to Tolyatti, the town where the Volga car plant was, to collect it, just over 2,000 kilometers away from where we were. Mum, despite her fear of cars, wanted a Zhiguli so much that she scrimped and saved every kopeck. She made dresses and coats for herself and the two of us, stitched on extra strips of cloth to the sleeves and hems as we grew, and fed us just enough to make sure we didn't die of hunger. Footnote: Soviet manufactured car of the 1970s, sold in the UK under the Lada label. The sea blue Zhiguli that they had bought at the factory, and in which they were driving back, overturned and ended up on its roof, in a ditch near Pinsk when their journey was almost over. They were already in their coffins when they were brought back home. It's been a long time since I last looked at the photographs of Mom Eva and Dad Tolik that Granny had kept. There weren't many, all rust-colored as a result of the poor quality fixer used in developing them. Finger-smudged memories of a few seconds of lives long gone. Dad's surname was Haden, just like Mum's, so she didn't even need to change her passport when they got married. People often used to tell me how like Dad's mother, Yulia, I was. Nobody ever said anything like that to my sister, Yulia, who was, after all, given the same name. My memories of Granny Yulia are even murkier than what I can recall of my parents. Just a general sense of boundless kindness and vulnerability in her eyes and wrinkles. According to Granny Makrinya, Granny Yulia was the type of woman who allowed herself to be used as a doormat. When she was young and the children were still small, she was regularly beaten by her husband. And he was a whole head shorter than she was. Later on, I saw both the paramedic and the nurse a few times. I saw her in the church in Stradce, a skinny woman with a weather-beaten face, definitely one of us, huge hands, work-worn and calloused, still wearing what had been fashionable in the first half of the 20th century, blouse, jumper, skirt, and headscarf. The paramedic had a round, well-fed face covered with a web of fine red veins. His fingers were chubby and squeaky clean. His clothes were drab and cheap, bought in the Brest shop called simply clothing. As an educated man, and therefore a member of the intellectual elite, the local elite, of course, he was always getting himself elected onto the local council. Neither of them is with us now. Nor is the rural hospital in Dobratyche, where Yulia and I first came into the world. Dobratyche has been renamed. Presumably the association with fools, Duri, was too strong. Now we call it Znamenka. I suppose this was to make us think of the banner, Znamia, of communism, leading us forwards. So the hospital is in Znamenka. This, we must assume, has made it a better place. We were driven from the hospital in Dobratyche to our home village of Dobratyche along a road that twists its way through fields, right next to the frontier, past tumble-down little farmsteads basking in the warm sun, to one side, adder-infested oak woods and a marsh. Then comes the hill. From here, you can see the houses of Dobratyche next to the cemetery. Then there's another marsh. White, cotton-like seed heads of bulrushes, reeds swaying over the mucky brown water, yellow irises. There's a place right by the barbed wire of the frontier where, if you stand on tiptoe, you can just about make out a few apple trees and lilac bushes some distance away. You can see it all much more clearly in springtime. It was here, right by the lilac, where the village of Dobratyche once stood, before 1939, before the Soviets came. Footnote, 1939 was the year of the Nazi-Soviet pact. The westernmost frontier of the Soviet Union was fixed along the River Bug and remained there after the end of the World War II. Before the arrival of progress and hygiene. Stradce, Dobratyche, Dobratyche. This was how the locals still said the names of the villages in our area when I was young, with a very soft-sounding ch. Footnote, a modern map of the Brest region of Belarus will show the road leading southwards towards the Ukrainian frontier. Driving along it, you would first arrive in Priluki after leaving Brest, followed by Zakazanka and Stradce, although the map, if it is in Belarusian, will tell you that you are in Stradzech. If it is Russian, you will be in Stradichi. Then you will come to Znamenka, once Durichi. The one village you will not find on this road is Dobratyche, the village in which the narrator of this book lives. It exists, but on the Polish side of the river, where it is spelt in the Polish fashion. The author has exercised her right to place the village wherever she wants. The names hadn't changed in the slightest since the register of 1566 was produced. I came across this document when I was a student doing fieldwork in the archives of the town of Lutsk in Ukraine, and read it, trembling with excitement. Who had these villages once belonged to? Was there someone called Strada, and had he been a martyr, Stradnik, to some kind of cause? Was Dobratyche founded by a kind, Dobry, fellow? And had Durichia been rudely named because the people living there were regarded as fools, Duri? There was another village listed in the register, Lyubchia, that by the time I came along, no one living locally had ever heard of, or even knew where this settlement of 40 homesteads had once stood. It had simply disappeared. It was no more, this little place that may have belonged to a woman called Lyubo, love. All the other villages were still there. It was in Durichia that we were born, me and my sister, and in Dobratyche we lived. For centuries, my ancestors had toiled away here, in Stradzie, Lyubcie, and Dobratyche, living out their lives day after day with no sense of order or purpose. Beings with no faces, freezing cold, bodies covered with sores and pus, living in holes, with no idea who they were. Fortunately, there are none of them left. Progress, hygiene, and the Soviets have won. Basking in the warm sun and fanned by the occasional breeze, the ghosts of ancient farmsteads and the people who once inhabited them, the ghosts of the adder-infested oak woodlands live on. The very first, Belarusian astronaut, Piotr Klimuk, was born not far from us, in the village of Kamaroka. The composer Ihar Kanyalyuk comes from Hershuni. Andrei Dinko, editor of Nasha Niva, Our Pasture, was born in Zakazanka. And, as my readers in Belarus probably already know, the poet Mikas Yarash lives in our very own Dobratyche. If I hadn't invited our famous poet, Mikas Yarash, over to our house for a visit, there wouldn't have been two murders. The Baptists wouldn't have built a chapel for themselves. And that airship, the very latest model, by the way, all shiny, fast, and completely see-through, would never have started flying tourists on excursions over Dobratyche, Stradzie, and Zakazanka. A great deal would never have happened if I had taken my laptop out of the house into the yard. But it's old and won't work properly unless it's plugged into the mains. It keeps shutting down or playing up in all sorts of odd ways. So I invited Mikas to come over to the house, and soon after that, the phone rang. Welcome to Dobratyche. Come on over and visit us in Dobratyche. We'll be really glad to see you. This is the place where the whole story, as dangerous as literature itself, it's hard to believe that I was the one it happened to, actually took place. This is the village eulogized, well, that's perhaps a bit of an exaggeration, by our local poet, Mikas Yarash. A guy so talented that even in Belarus, one person in every 20 has heard of him, let alone in Europe. And that's in spite of the fact that he writes in Belarusian. Okay, he writes in Ukrainian as well. Our village is situated in a glorious forest of fir trees. They call them bariyaki round here, a word you won't hear anywhere else. These trees really do remind you of people. We've got real sand dunes as well, although there's no sea round here, invisible or otherwise. On the other hand, there are several springs. In one of them, the water is salty. These days, we're allowed to go right up to the River Buch. It doesn't take more than 15 minutes to reach it. But back then, you couldn't get anywhere near it. The frontier was shut fast. There was barbed wire, the plowed-up strip of no man's land. Don't even think of trying to get across it. And an alarm system. Yes, indeed, we had a real problem with water in Dobratyche at the time. That explains why the little bay by the sluice gates on the drainage canal was so popular. People even came down from Brest to enjoy a day by the water. There was also a problem with the primeval lack of humankind, the boundless solitude in Dobratyche that Michas writes about. That goes some way to explain why, when I was a child, meeting another human being among the ancient firs and aspens was a real event. More often than not, all you met were ferrets, pine martens, and striped wild piglets. Then came the cancerous growth of whole estates of dachas and a station on the railway line. Almost all the animals disappeared. In their stead came the townies. Maybe Mikas meant that you couldn't call them people. He was wrong there. These folk are the cream of our society, the best of the best. The gardening clubs that sprang up around Dobratyche had names like War Veteran, Defender of the Fatherland, and Rainbow. They were slightly dotty, these rulers of our world, but they were also dangerous, and my grandmother always put on a special, respectful voice when she was talking to them. Granny was 97, the last of the Mohicans among the original inhabitants of our village. Whenever a retired major or lieutenant colonel, always in well-worn blue trousers that sagged at the bottom and the knees, came near our fence, she would always offer them a drink of water and bring out a metal cup that was covered in chicken shit. Granny was one of the poor in spirit, one of those to whom the kingdom of heaven belongs. If she had succumbed to the temptation to commit suicide some 20 years earlier, as she really wanted to, then she most likely would never enter that particular kingdom. As things are, there's no problem. She will. In the era of dachas, fences around the village houses began to make their appearance. There had been no use for them before. You simply put a twig through the latch as a sign that you weren't at home, and that you would rather no one entered while you were out. Now there are high fences everywhere, and anything that weighs less than a ton is securely locked away. Previously, it was only the gypsies that people were wary of. Now they're afraid of each other. But I should get back to that evening in June, when a young fellow with a gun opened our gate and came into the yard. Welcome to our polyphonic world. It's people like my granny who support the world on their shoulders. She's sitting opposite me right now, at a table that's gone black with age. From time to time, dry pine needles drop from the tall tree next to us onto the table, and into the pan with fried potatoes and our mugs of kvass. Footnote, a very slightly alcoholic drink made from fermented black bread. People round here call these needles shipata, presumably after the sound they make when the wind blows through them. We're having our supper in the open air, just like we've done many times over the past 50 years. There were times when other people joined us. Mom, Dad, Yulia, her children, my daughter. But now Yulia is in Norway, where she is lecturing to the scholarly descendants of the Vikings about the journeyings of their restless ancestors. Her children, Lena and Kazik, are in Minsk. So here we are, just the two of us. The 7 o'clock train has just chugged off to town, taking the townies from the dachas with it. Dobratyche is at peace again. The wind has dropped, and the voices have fallen silent. There are just the villagers left, 5 homesteads in all. They, too, are eating their supper under the ancient oaks, or settling their domestic animals down for the night. So, imagine our surprise when at this quiet hour, a young man with a holster on his hip came casually walking down our village street. If, that is, a deeply rutted sand track with patches of wild oats growing here and there is worthy of the name street. And looking round in a perfectly relaxed way, stopped by our gate, opened it, and came into the yard where we were sitting. What did he want from us? Where had he come from? Young, dark-haired, open, honest face, and with a gun. You could see at once that he wasn't some kind of robber, but then what do I know about people? So who was he? Everything soon became clear. Good evening. I'm your local police officer. Rudkovsky is the name. Call me Andre. Can I come in? This in Russian. Granny looked at him with interest. What do you want, sonny? She asked in reply, in Ukrainian. Can I ask you to draw me some water? It's still terribly hot. Granny nodded in my direction, so I handed a clean mug to the lad. He drew, his word after all, a bucketful of water from the well, enjoyed his drink, and then rinsed out the mug. The body of a man was found on the road not far from here. Do you know anything about it? He asked, looking at me. We didn't hear anything, replied Granny. What sort of man was it? Through the thick lenses of her spectacles, Granny gave him the kind of look that demanded a reply. The lad heaved an almost imperceptible sigh and began his story. Stop. Hang on a minute. What language should I use to tell you what happened here? This is, in fact, not a simple question. The people of Dobratyche speak Ukrainian, but there aren't many of them. The director of the firm called Agrovitalika Plus, Vital Charota, speaks Belarusian. He was evacuated here after the Chernobyl disaster of 1986, from somewhere near Chachersk. Now and again, my readers in Belarus will occasionally mumble a few words in Belarusian, but on the whole, Russian dominates here. Charota, or the local police officer, the local newspaper, or the doctor, or the Baptist pastor, will sometimes lace their speech with a juicy Ukrainian phrase or two, something that the young local Orthodox priest and his good lady wife would never do. As I've already said, the earth speaks Ukrainian, but only very, very rarely. The wind whistles in its own way, beyond any human language. So, Velkom to our polyphonic world. This is what the young police officer told us. Our local Dobratyche news agency, our newsmaker, or, in other words, our local gossip, is known hereabouts as Leonika, which is our village way of saying that she is Leonia's missus. So her husband's name is Leonia, or to be formal, Leonid. The police officer, who doesn't come from our village, politely calls her Auntie Masha, which means that her official first name is Maria. Anyway, Leonika was the primary source of information on this occasion as well. Yesterday, she was taking milk to sell to the townies in the dachas, when all of a sudden she spotted someone lying on a slope by the road. It turned out to be one of the townies. Gray Toper, we used to call him, because of his gray hair and his fondness for the hard stuff. He was lying in a position that was unnatural, even for him. On closer inspection, Leonika saw that he was dead, so she went back home and called the police. They soon arrived on the scene and ascertained that aforementioned Gray Toper had been dispatched by three drinking companions to the shop in Priluki to replenish their depleted supplies of alcohol. It looked like he had been knocked down by a car. All this had been put on record yesterday. Today's visit by the police had, however, been occasioned by the fact that Gray Toper's widow had reported her husband's bicycle missing. According to her, it was on this bicycle that he had set off on the final journey of his life, and when the police turned up, there was no sign of it near the body. No, we don't know anything about it. Leonika didn't come and see us yesterday. This was me confirming, in Russian, of course, our complete lack of information. Okay, thanks for the water. Really tasty. I'll get off then. Maybe Auntie Masha's already got back. So off the young fellow went, obviously in no great hurry. There's a copse of aspen trees between us and Leonika's house, but even so, we soon heard a great racket coming from that direction. Leonika's gone as deaf as a post in her old age, so the police officer really had to strain his voice to get his message across.
Was there anyone around when you found the body? Did you see anything else?
We could hear the officer yelling.
Believe me, I didn't see anyone. There wasn't anyone around at all. No, I didn't see a bicycle.
Leonika's loud replies came drifting towards us. Strictly speaking, this episode with the police officer was not directly linked to what happened afterwards. It wasn't the actual pebble that started the avalanche. That particular pebble shifted in another place and at another time. But it was the first abnormal, unexpected event in a whole string of such events that came tumbling down on me so insistently that I was soon suffocating beneath a whole avalanche of them. Henik the Uruguayan, His Love and Luck. It's possible that the first pebble was dislodged by Henik Hadden the Uruguayan. That same slim, handsome Henik Hadden the Uruguayan, who's fond of cheap booze and chasing skirts, whose wife Katya often moans about him to the other women of the village when they're out working in the fields. Carpenter, beekeeper, and all-round general handyman, in old trousers and usually with no shoes or socks on, he's so closely tied to the earth that he may well have been the one who set the avalanche rolling. If I'm right, then it all started the following morning. The grass in the yard had turned yellow with the heat. The sun was blazing down on us more and more fiercely. Even the fir trees sound different in the completely dry air than they do normally. These tall, majestic trees managed to look as though the all-consuming, scorching heat was of no concern to them whatsoever. But of course, they do have roots, which reach down almost as far as the earth's core. The ground beneath our feet is one mighty network of roots, a living world beneath the surface, the invisible part of God's great miracle. Granny flung her stick at one of the chickens. Her stick is an inseparable part of her. It's both a symbol and a tool of her authority. She uses it to hit the chickens, wallop the cat, or poke the cow. That's her all over. True, she never actually hits them. The chicken flapped its wings a bit, just to show how frightened it was, and jumped away from the porch where it had been headed.
"I'll give you what for," shouts Granny, as she always does when she tries to hit the animals.
I never did understand what it was that she would give them. I hand Granny her stick. She's washing herself at the battered old wash basin that stands in the yard. She's placed her glasses on the shelf and rested her stick against the fir tree. I look at her. She's all skin and bone, almost blind, and I'm sure she's grown shorter. The hard skin of her hands is cracked and encrusted with earth that will never wash out. Her face, once so powerful, gaunt, and sharp, has gone dry. Her grandchildren call her a witch whenever they come down to see us in Dobratyche. Her hands tremble as she pours water on her eyes. The hands are filthy. She'll never get them clean. Looking at her jogs my memory. I am lying in bed with really bad stomach ache and throwing up all the time. Some infection that children catch from dirty hands. The soil that gets ingrained in tiny cracks in the skin. Granny is cussing and swearing all the time while waiting for my parents to arrive from town. My being ill is stopping her from going out to the fields. Everyone gets the rough edge of her tongue. Her thoughtless, worthless daughter who swanned off to town, leaving her behind with these bleeding kids, me and Yulia, together, because they prevent her, Makrinya, from going out to the fields.
You wipe their bottoms and they won't so much as give you a drink of water in your old age.
The only thing she does for me is to shove a bowl under my face when I'm being sick, and then, cursing again, she takes it away. As soon as my parents turn up, she leaves us and runs off to the fields. She has no time for tablets or doctors. Still, for all that her hands were filthy, she did bring me up, whereas I, with clean hands, was unable to do the same for my daughter. Gran, where's the basket for the windfall apples? I ask. I know perfectly well where the basket is. When I'm 97, my granddaughter is not going to ask me where something is just to hear the sound of my voice. And every day, when she's cooking something, she will never ask me to taste it to see if there's enough salt in it. Simply because I will never have a granddaughter. Granny, with a triumphant face that clearly says, "What would you do without me?" brings out the basket. "Should I go down to the apple trees?" I ask. And again, I know what the answer is going to be.
"No, no need for that. I'll do it myself. You'd do better to go to the woods and see what mushrooms you can find and make soup for supper."
Granny is always looking for something to do, like collecting apples or weeding the rows of vegetables and flowers. Then I have to go and replant the growing onions, carrots, and asters that she has torn out by the roots because she can't see what she's doing.
"Or there on the hill, the reapers are reaping?"
A line from a Ukrainian song suddenly came drifting over the fence. For some reason, there was a question mark distinctly audible at the end. It was Henik, the Uruguayan. His legs had given way. He grabbed hold of the fence, swayed a couple of times, and then, with a downward gesture of the hand that eloquently said, "Sod it," he succumbed to the inevitable and collapsed on the ground at full stretch after deftly placing his cap under his head. "My wife, my dear heart, we don't get along." He continued to address questions to the sky until Granny and I got to him. He has a fine, silky, smooth voice. His face is lean, his arms tanned by the sun and hard work.
"Henik, get up!" Granny gave him a poke with her stick. "The sun's still up and you've already had a skinful."
"When the sun goes down, love goes out the door," Henik parried in response.
The nickname Uruguayan was passed down to Henik from his grandfather, who at the dawn of modern times had gone off to seek his fortune in Uruguay. So all his heirs were now called Uruguayans. When I was a child, I believed that this was their actual surname. Only later did I discover that their real surname was Hadden, the same as everyone else in Dobratyche. Yes, That's right. We all come from the same stock with the same surname. We're like each other, heavily built, with faces that look as though they've been rough-hewn out of wood with an axe, flat noses broad at the bridge, high, prominent foreheads, strong jawlines, and uneven teeth. But no one can say that the people of Dobratyche are ugly. There's an urge to live within us that gives us something more than mere saccharine beauty. However, at this particular moment, Henik Haran's urge to live had drained right out of him into the ground under the influence of alcohol. All he could do was declaim verses. "Oh, 'twere better had I ne'er known love," he uttered, turned on one side, and closed his eyes. Granny and I exchanged glances. "We'll have to let Katya know," I said. "She can come and collect him." "She'll never be able to lug him home. He's far too heavy. Get the sheepskin coat and put it under him so he doesn't lie right on the ground." This is Granny giving instructions. As it turned out, I didn't need to fetch the sheepskin coat. Remember our poet, Mikas Yarash? He's better known around here as Mishik Yarashishin. Think of him as Yarash's missus's grandson, Mikey. Well, he appeared all of a sudden with a rake slung over one shoulder and wearing a t-shirt proclaiming, "Irmoshina can't count." Footnote: this is presumably a dig at Lydia Irmoshina, the chair of the Central Electoral Commission in Belarus. Accusations of vote rigging are always being leveled at her. He was on his way back home from haymaking and decided to call in on us. "I'll take him," he said, quickly sizing up the situation. "I'll leave the rake here. I was going to come round to see you anyway," and now he was talking just to me. "I wanted to ask you how you can get Ukrainian spell check in Word." "Mishik lives quite close to us. It won't be long, I reckon, before busloads of tourists come to visit the house where the famous poet lives. For the moment, though, not a day passes without some bearded intellectual type calling on him. Mikas's granny, Yarashika herself, is a practical woman who gets them involved in all sorts of urgent domestic work, such as haymaking. Today, however, Mishik was going back home after haymaking on his own. "It's easy," I said. "Drop in when you come back for your rake and I'll show you." Mishik grabbed Henik unceremonially under the armpits and brought him to his feet, brushed him down, and said, "Off we go, old man. Katya's waiting for you. She'll pour you a glass of something good, I'm sure." Henik lifted an ironic eyebrow, but allowed himself to be led home. Mishik was laughing when he got back. "I don't know about a glass of something good. What he did get from Katya was a good walloping." Henik had been up at the place that belongs to those venereologists re-roofing their root cellar. They were the ones who got him drunk. Katya's locked him in the house and gone off to have it out with them. So, what about the spell checker? We went through into my room where the big table that served as my desk was. On it, next to the computer, stood a great pile of files and papers. I really had intended to do some work on them, but as things turned out, all my hopes were in vain. I didn't have time to wipe my nose, let alone do anything constructive on the computer. I switched my notebook on and showed Mishik what he needed to do to load the spell checker. The phone rang. I ran to the kitchen. It was Yulia calling from Norway, so we didn't talk for long. "How are things with you?" she asked. "Why don't you pay your mobile phone bill? There's no point in having one if it's always blocked. How's Granny?"
"Everything's okay. Don't worry, just get your Vikings sorted out."
"I'll be arriving in 3 days' time. I've bought the ticket already. You don't need to meet me. What can I bring back from here?"
"Rain. It's like the Sahara here."
While waiting for me to finish on the phone, Mishik was fiddling around with the different options on Word.
"Yulia's coming, is she?" he asked.
"Yulia is an archaeologist. She's giving a paper at some conference or other in Norway. As far as I remember, the title of her paper is Archaeological Evidence for the Presence of Vikings on the Territory of the Principality of Polotsk in the 10th Century. Footnote. Polotsk, the oldest city in Belarus, and in early medieval times, the center of a large principality that is regarded as the first Belarusian state. But maybe that's not it. I may have got it completely wrong. I'm not all that strong when it comes to dealing with scholarly topics, even though I am a historian by training. Yes, in 3 days' time. It was right at that moment that I got to witness an act of poetic creation. Poets forget completely about everything around them and go off into their own world. All of a sudden, Mishik seemed to be staring at something a long way away. He asked again about the spell checker, something that I had already explained to him only a few moments earlier. I quite enjoyed the spectacle of another poem taking shape in his head. Could he perhaps have a soft spot for Yulia? Was it the news of her imminent arrival that had had this effect on him? I patiently explained everything to him again. Granny clattered into the house, bringing with her the windfall apples from our orchard. The noise aroused Mikas from his reverie. He stood up and went home. Then he had to come back a bit later for his rake. The sun continued to sear us with its ferocious heat. It became impossible to walk barefoot on the sand. The leaves on the lilac bushes had shriveled up. You could at least cool off a little inside the house. While I was cleaning the mushrooms, I thought lazily, in that heat, there was no other way to do anything, about Yulia's arrival, about how happy she would be to see Granny still strong and active, about how happy she would be to see me. I knew she would have to do no more than quickly cast an inquisitive glance in my direction to see instantly right through me. She is the only person who knows exactly what things are like between me and Anton. She is better than I am. She is my mirror image, except the image I see is better and purer and doesn't walk with a limp. When she was giving birth to her children, I felt the pain. When I was in prison, she lost weight. Our lives are like two streams. The waters run side by side, but they never mingle. I was still a student when I married Anton. Good Lord, where did my life go? He did well for himself in the business world, and we bought ourselves a flat in Minsk. Then, of course, I became trapped in the vicious circle of running between the kitchen and the dining room and back again, until I was given the diagnosis. You will never be able to have children. That was 17 years ago. Your stories are full of extremes, Dinko said to me not long ago. A Frenchman comes to study the habits of townspeople who rent houses in the country for the summer. He gets himself murdered and his body is dumped on the municipal tip. Not very likely, is it? What about the tasty aroma of food, cooking in the kitchen, the cool fragrance of clean linen in the cupboard, the gentle, homely feel of a lamplit room in the evening, the waxy shine on the leaves of a ficus plant? How likely is it that all of that can, in an instant, be robbed of any meaning by a guilty verdict consisting of 8 words? You will never be able to have children. Barren fig tree, seed cast on stony ground. And then there was Anton's face, utterly lost, not knowing where to go or what to do. And then there was the miracle, the birth of my daughter. And then there was death. The doctor who first diagnosed my little daughter with cancer worked in hospital number 2. I simply don't recall how I ever got out of there. Somewhere on Starozhuskaya Street, I stopped being able to breathe. I collapsed against the rough wall of some old building. Everything went dark, and I began to vomit,
curled up on a manhole by a food store. I was lying on the snow, but the snow wasn't cold. I came round when a little dog started barking right above me. A woman shook me by the shoulder. "What's wrong? Can you get up?" It was Maria Vatsyashanak with her little dog Murza. 2 years later, she would rescue me again, when I was high on drugs and oblivious to the world. She helped me get into the psychiatric hospital in Navinki and undergo treatment for my addiction. When Anton and I got married, both of us experienced, as far as we possibly could, that thing called love. We were open to each other, as far as we possibly could be. We were drawn to each other. But then the stage of infatuation passed, and we entered into a stage of close friendship, so close that it seemed unbreakable. But break it did. It's difficult to put up with a wife who happens to be a drug addict, even if you really want to. And he didn't. A drug addict for a wife, no children, no desire to go on living, no light in the eyes, no life in the hair. That's why I wasn't surprised when a woman phoned me out of the blue and, obviously relishing the moment, said, "In the circles they move in, it's considered bad form not to have a mistress. It's simply a must-have in business. You must be either blind or completely out of your mind." So there it is then. No mind and no sight. Just soft in mind, no will to do anything, and body, rolls of cellulite on my hips. What was there to be surprised about? The night after the rain came. At last, the long-awaited rain came. Once rain has fallen, it's absolutely essential to earth up the potatoes before the heat has had a chance to dry out the soil again. This is serious work, much more serious than it might seem to an ordinary internet user or, say, some kind of high-flying manager. Granny wanted to rush out and do the job on the same day, and I had difficulty in holding her back. The previous winter, she had had a cataract removed, and the doctor warned her not to do anything that involved heavy labor. There was, of course, no way in which she would willingly refrain from doing anything that needed doing, and it was virtually impossible for anyone else to stop her. She's become so used to doing everything herself, there's no job that she thinks is too hard for her. As a result, she occasionally suffers from a discharge of the eye that was operated on. The only way for me to stop her was to do it all myself, before she had had a chance to realize what had happened. We had been talking for a long time about the need to earth up the potatoes. All we were waiting for was the rain. I simply hadn't managed to get around to the potatoes today. I had been busy all day, of course, under Granny's close supervision, with weeding and replanting the beetroot, another urgent job that needs to be done after rain. That's why I knew that first thing tomorrow, while I was still cooking breakfast, Granny would be raring to get out to the spuds, hoe in hand. Then she would have trouble with her eye again. There was only one thing for it. I would have to go out myself tonight to do the job. It was 11 o'clock in the evening when I smothered myself in a good liter of liquid to keep the mosquitoes off and crept quietly out of the house so as not to wake up Granny. The villagers of Dobratyche have their allotments right on the frontier, at a spot where the soil is rich with the silt left behind whenever the river floods, as it has done for centuries. To get there, you have to go through the forest for a little way. There's nothing finer than a moonlit night in our village. The full moon bathes the world in a fantastic silvery light that contrasts sharply with the dense shadows. The sand dunes remind you of some exotic scene in Algeria, with those crystals they call desert roses. And the grass lower down the slopes looks like pictures out of a book of fairy tales. Nights like this are not only valuable for their own sake, they give some meaning to an otherwise empty existence. I had already hidden the hoe in one of the rows on the allotment. It would take me about 4 or 5 hours to finish the job, I reckoned, and there would be enough moonlight for me to do it properly in that time. I retrieved the hoe and got down to work. Down on the river, the frogs were giving a concert. I tried to work smoothly, without haste, so as not to tire myself out too quickly. Fitness classes and the swimming pool aren't enough to prepare you for working out in the fields. I had never known the kind of hardships that the old women of Dobratyche had had to endure in their lifetime in order to survive. I lacked their stamina and skill. At the age of 90, Granny could dig potatoes faster than I could at 40. It was with enlightening thoughts like these that I worked my way up and down a few furrows and stopped for a rest. I heard a gentle tinkling noise coming from the path at one end of the allotments. Someone was riding a bike. The bell jingled every time the wheels went over a rut. I instinctively crouched down behind a blackcurrant bush. Meeting anyone face to face was not part of my plans, especially as I could clearly make out by the moonlight who it was on the bike. The imperturbable Yonika, the village gossip. Where on earth could she be going at this time of night? She was riding along quite slowly, obviously afraid of falling off onto the path at night. As always, she was muttering something to herself, but I couldn't hear what. At last, the jingling died away. Just as well I had hidden myself in time. Otherwise, by morning, the whole village, and all the dachas as well, would have learned that Makrinya's girl Ala goes out at night, hexing other people's crops. And Leonika, no doubt, would have been prepared to swear that she had seen a long, spindle-like tail sticking out of my backside. I know her only too well. I had scarcely had time to get my breath back when someone else appeared, this time on the other side of the allotment where the road is, walking quickly in the opposite direction. This was our famous poet, Mikas Yarash, striding out purposefully, but looking around now and again as if he was nervous of something. In the moonlight, his face looked unusually pale. He didn't see me either. At least, I don't think he did. I waited for a few more minutes, then stood up from behind my bush, breathed deeply, and picked up the hoe again. Good Lord, I never knew that there was so much going on in our village at night. Never. Miracles will never cease. Where was Leonika off to in the middle of the night, and what for? Surely not a love tryst? You might think that her time for love had long since passed. Come to think of it, though, it's quite possible that she'll marry again. It will be her fourth time if she does. But it isn't really likely that she'd go riding round the village on her bike at night for the sake of a hug and a kiss. So where was she going? And what about Mikas? Has he got a girl up there in one of the dachas? After all, that was the direction he was going in. Curiosity was biting harder than the mosquitoes. The perfumery departments of the big stores haven't yet begun to sell a scent that will ward off curiosity. As the saying goes, there is no cure for curiosity. If we weren't curious, we'd be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.